Hi there, everyone, and happy spring. We are here on a cloudy Monday, and we are celebrating spring together. It's going to be a fun live stream. Camera guy has the fire going. Mac just took off to the side, but he just said happy spring before he took off, and it's finally here. Can you guys believe it? It just seems like yesterday we were doing happy fall and happy winter, and even last year, happy spring, but this is what we've all been waiting for, right? It's time to grow our veggies. Hopefully, fingers crossed, we're almost done with the cold winter, and I know a lot of you are still having snow. The snow is melting. We're actually just getting our 12th, believe it or not, atmospheric river of the year, of the winter, tomorrow and Wednesday. So pretty crazy. We're not quite done yet, but we're getting there, and nothing's going to get us down today. We're very excited that spring is here and we are ready to grow veggies. I hope you are too. Today's going to be a fun one. The topic is how to bring the pollinators into your garden. We're also doing a giveaway for two winners. We'll receive one of my Grow Your Groceries with Calichem subscription boxes. Hopefully everyone entered. You had to comment on the soggy soil video that we did towards the end of last week to enter. Hope y'all commented over there. And we're going to do a random draw for two lucky winners today on this very live stream. So it's going to be a fun one. So let me say hello to those of you who are here in the chat. It was a really fun pre-chat live stream today. We're here every Monday in the chat at quarter till noon Pacific time. Cliff and Nisha are in the chat at 11:30. Smart Pots is here, and everyone's just so excited about spring here in the chat. Gardening is my peace. Hello. Great to have you here today. If you are new to our live streams, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. Spring is a perfect time to start gardening. Now's the time to get rolling. End of the Road, Gordon Flower Farm. How you doing? Great to have you here. Gardener Tom, always good to see you. Christina, hello from Kansas. Philoma, hi, how are you doing today? And let's see who else. Angela from Maryland is here. Sandy, great to have you here. Tina D, Lemmy, how are you doing? Looks so cozy. And hopefully, Lemmy, you won't get too hard hit with that rain. I think you guys might be getting it first down in San Diego, but hopefully your garden is not getting too terribly soggy. V is here, Nisha and Cliff, all kinds of things to celebrate today, and it is going to be a good one. Glory T, how are you? Great to have you here. It's always good to see the familiar faces of those of you that join us every single week, and we want to thank you for spending your Mondays with us, especially today on the first day of spring. So it's all about the pollinators today, and pollinators work so hard and bring us all of our veggies that we eat. So they're super important to have in your garden, and we want to really focus on planting for the pollinators, because the more pollinators you have, the more fruits and veggies you're going to have in your garden. So the more that you can plant for the pollinators, the better off your veggie garden is going to be. So that's why it's a really, really big focus for my garden. In fact, I've been actually dedicating the past couple of years, rather than growing every single garden bed full of vegetables, I've actually been dedicating several of my garden beds just to flowers. Not only because we always have an abundance of vegetables, but it's just so beautiful to see the pops of color. And I can't believe how many more bees and butterflies I had last year because I kind of switched over some of my garden beds. So I want to encourage you to do that too. But if you're not getting as many vegetables as you would like, chances are it might be because you don't have enough pollinators in your garden. Now, you can definitely hand pollinate a lot of your veggies, but that can be really labor intensive, and it's always a little bit iffy whether or not you're going to get more veggies from that or not. So the best thing you can do is to plant for the pollinators. Excuse me just a moment. Grab a sip of water here. So pollinators' main source of food is nectar and pollen. Now, nectar comes from flowers. It's the liquid kind of sugary substance inside a lot of flowers. And pollen is kind of the powdery, a lot of times it's yellow substance that's on the outside of some flowers. But they really do enjoy both. The nectar is really their main source of, their main source of energy. And the pollen, they get the proteins and fats from the pollen. So the first tip that I want to share with you that you can really do to bring the pollinators in is mix it up. Don't just plant your flowers way over on one side of your garden. You don't have to have dedicated garden beds just for flowers, although you can. can, but bring in flowers alongside of your vegetables. So don't be afraid to do that. I get that question all the time. Is it okay to plant flowers in my garden beds? Absolutely, the more the merrier. I always like to kind of plant little flower borders along the edges of my garden beds or my containers, not only because it looks really, really pretty, but it just brings the pollinators in exactly where you need them. The closer you can get your flowers to your vegetables, your pollinators will be right there. They're gonna pollinate the flower, get the pollen and the nectar from the flowers, and then pollinate your vegetables and fruits and vegetable flowers as well. So definitely bring them in as close as you can to your veggie garden, your fruits containers, your raised beds, your in-ground garden beds, whatever you can. Plant tall ones in the back. Interplant them in between the vegetables and plant little spillers or little borders of flowers along the edges, and you're going to absolutely love it. You're going to love the color. You're going to love seeing the bees and the butterflies flocking to your garden, and it really does make a huge difference, and you're just going to enjoy it so much. Now, besides mixing it up into your garden beds, also mix up the colors. Now, believe it or not, different pollinators do have different preferences for flowers or for colors. I don't know if you've ever noticed that. But bees really enjoy blue, yellow, white, purple, orange. If you saw my Instagram story this morning, you saw where I have some nasturtiums and calendulas planted, and I have some arugula that's bolted and flowering. And those are all colors that bees absolutely love. So whatever flowers that you can find with those colors, I mean, they like all kinds of different colors, but those are particular ones that they really enjoy. If you've ever grown just as lavender, it's the purple flowers that absolutely love those. Borage is another really beautiful purple flower. It's actually an herb as well that the bees absolutely love. Sunflowers, that bright yellow, the bees just buzz around that like crazy. The nasturtiums, I have tons of nasturtiums that are just getting ready to bloom. They absolutely love those. Sweet alyssum is a really beautiful one. It's I have some in purple and some in white, but it's kind of a trailing type of flower. It's good for ground cover. If you have clover in your lawn, the big trend now is to leave the clover in your lawn for the bees. They absolutely love that. So just focus on those particular colors, especially if you could only choose a few for the bees. Now, hummingbirds are particular to red. They love the red. In the summertime, I always plant scarlet runner beans on a trellis right over here. It kind of trails over to the backside of my deck, and there's always tons of hummingbirds. We have our little hummingbird feeder right there that's red. It's funny, I have a blue hummingbird, or I have a blue one down below in the garden, a hummingbird feeder. They never go to that one. They always come to this one here. This is their favorite. So I think I need to get a couple more of those red hummingbird feeders to place around my garden. So any type of red flowers, the hummingbirds love those. And butterflies enjoy red and purple. They love zinnias, wildflower mix, milkweed. So if there's any few that you could focus on for the particular pollinators that you want to bring to your garden, or why not just plant the rainbow and plant them all? And that way you can mix it up and bring the pollinators in and also bring the beautiful colors into your garden. So let's jump here in the chat here. Oh, and the other thing I wanted to mention is if you can plant wider bands of flowers too, like maybe in clumps of 3 to 5 flowers or just a wide band of flowers, the pollinators will see those. Their eye will be drawn to that a little bit more. And that way you'll be able to bring more to your garden as well. So a few little tips there. And if you can also plant perennials which bloom year after year, then that way you don't have to work quite so hard to plant as many flowers every year. And I've got a ton of resources for you over at CallieKimGardeningHome.com. I love planting flowers. So I have five or six flower seed collections that really focus on bringing in the pollinators at different times of the year. This is the warm weather pollinator collection. There's the cool weather one for those early spring days. Of course, sunflowers are my absolute favorite. And then zinnias. You can never have too many zinnias in your garden, in my opinion. And then, of course, the red flower seed collection, because my favorite color is red, and I love to plant red flowers whenever I can. And today, just to celebrate spring, I am having a 30% off sale over at CallieKimGardeningHome.com. gardeninghome.com. It applies to seed collections, the garden kits, my books, as well as the Calichem Smart Pots. And I wanted to offer it today, especially today only for spring, 30% off, a big discount, because that way more people can garden and get their seeds that they need for spring. So head over, use the code SPRINGISHERE. Today only ends at midnight Pacific time. So, okay, we are going to do our drawing in just a moment for our first winner for the Calichem Grow Your Grocery sub box. But before we do, let me head into the chat and see if there's any comments or questions to celebrate the first day of spring. I'd love to hear also what your favorite flower to plant for the pollinators is in the chat here. V says, I have stuck flowers. They are purple. It smells like honey. I'm not quite sure what flower you're talking about, but it smells like a beautiful one. Absolutely love that. Angela says, I have Kim's red flower seed collection. It's a fun one. It's always fun to see those bright splashes of color. Nothing like some color to lift your spirits after a cold winter time, right? Let's see, homesteading with Kim. I love the pollinators. If you bring them in, if you bring them in, you will have a great garden, and I couldn't agree more. Not only a beautiful, beautiful garden that you will enjoy, but you'll have lots and lots of veggies. Let's see here, camera guy, ready for the drawing. Sure. So we are going to do a drawing. This is so exciting. A lot of you have already subscribed to our brand new Grow Your Groceries with Calichem subscription box. We're doing a drawing today. We actually sold out of all the first month's boxes, but we have two left that we're going to give away today. So there are not other boxes like this available. The contents, that is. Our new boxes go on sale for April at the end of this week. But this is the only ones left in existence. So this is our Grow Your Grocery subscription box. And we have made some cool improvements to the design of the box, some slight improvements. Camera guy, can you go ahead and open that up there?
Sure.
All right. We're going to grow our groceries together. It couldn't be easier to grow your groceries. But here are the contents of the month one box, okay? Every month, these are some things that you are going to get. And every month you will be getting some special surprises as well. Each month's box has a theme. The month one box was Grow a Salad Station. So if you've already got yours, let us know in the comments what you're enjoying about it. There's four different seed packets, some lettuce seed packets and a radish seed packet. And none of these seeds are in any of my seed collections. So they're very unique to the subscription boxes each month. You also get some soil. It's a coco core amended with worm casting soil that expands to fill these wonderful cow pots, which I love these. So you're going to fill them with soil, plant your seeds. And then the first month's box also gets a bottle of Vermistera Vitality. It's also going to be in the second month's box as well. Little spoiler alert there. I know.
You said it?
Yes, I did. I said it. So that's kind of a free little bonus. You get some little sticky traps to grow inside to catch those annoying fungus gnats. And our the artist for our box, who happens to be my niece, did an amazing job. And we tried to put all of our fun little touches here. We've got some little stickers that actually coordinate with the seed packet. So you've got your vegetable stickers that are the same vegetables that you're growing. And you have fun little, the vegetable that you're growing is in your grocery cart here. And I'm holding it on the back. So these are super fun. We put lots of thought into it, lots of detail, lots of fun. You get a full-on instruction sheet and a special video only for the subscribers of the box. So we're going to draw the first winner right now. So we've got the YouTube random comment picker right in front of me. And yeah, Urban Chicken Mama, it's a great way to try the Vitality. You also will get a coupon in the box with your 8-ounce bottle of Vitality. And we're going to turn my camera around here to face my computer and do our random comment picker. Thank you very much, camera guy. Appreciate your help on that. So we're going to copy and paste the link to the video right in here, and it will pull up all the comments. So it's a really fun way for people to get started. And let me see here. Oh, I forgot they have you do math now to make sure you're not a bot or a robot or whatever. We'll get the YouTube comments. A lot of people participated in this. We really appreciate all your participation. It was really fun to read all of the comments. And then we're going to go ahead and start the raffle. You're going to see all the names scroll by. And this is for U.S. residents. We do only ship the box to the U.S. So hopefully this person is a U.S. resident. The name here is DeBaz. Congratulations, DeBaz. And DeBaz's comment says, knock on wood, I haven't had a huge issue with too wet of soil, but we'll definitely keep this in mind if it happens in my growing area. I'm looking forward to growing more peppers, beans of various varieties, and tomatoes, and lettuce too. Sure, I'll sprinkle in other veggies if I have room. So, Boz, thank you so much for entering. Congratulations on being the winner. Winners, please email me at kellykim@kellykimgardenandhome.com. Your contact information, your name, your YouTube name, and all your mailing information, and we'll get that subscription box sent out to you probably towards the end of the week. So thank you so much for entering. We'll be drawing for one more winner after our second tip. So definitely don't go away. And for those of you that have already ordered a subscription, the April boxes will be shipping the first week of April. If you haven't yet, we actually are going to be ordering or producing more boxes this month than we did last month since we sold out. So you still have a chance. You can grab one. They go on sale on March 25th. So do make sure you head over to our website, kellykimgardenandhome.com, and grab yours because they are going to go fast again this month. Okay, congratulations, DeBaz. And let's jump back into our tips for the pollinators, okay? All right, tip number two is keep the flowers blooming all season long, not just spring, but into the summer and into the fall. Now, this takes a little bit of doing, but it is really pretty an easy way to keep the pollinators coming all season. Because right now in my garden, I have calendula, nasturtiums blooming. I have some of the lettuce that is starting to bolt and go to flower blooming. The bees love those, but when the warm weather hits, those flowers are going to die off because of the heat. So think about that now and start planting perhaps indoors, if it's still too cold outdoors, some of your warm weather flowers like zinnias, sunflowers. I've got a big old tray of zinnias right over here, hardening off, getting ready to plant as soon as we get a little bit of warm weather. It's still a tad too cold for them. And so just keep the flowers blooming, plant flowers of different seasons, different bloom times. Zinnias have a very long bloom time. So those are the flowers that, those are super easy to grow flowers, and you can actually cut off the spent bloom on those, and they'll continue blooming all summer long. Or you can just kind of succession plant them like once a month and continually be popping in those zinnias into your garden and the sunflowers all summer long, so you have different bloom times. So some of the cool weather flowers that you can plant, I mentioned, are the calendulas, the nasturtiums. I have my whole cool season flower collection, 6 varieties in here. These are great to plant right now in early spring. And then again, get the warmer weather flowers going. The other seed collections that I have, get those rolling right along so that you have those to plant as the weather warms up, and then just keep succession planting those. And then in the fall, you can start planting, or I would probably start in late August, start planting some of your cool season flowers again to take you through the fall and into the winter months. So keep it going, keep those bees and butterflies coming in. And also keep in mind, a lot of vegetables, such as the scarlet runner beans, have beautiful red flowers and bring in the bees like crazy, as well as do some of the herbs. But we'll talk about herbs in just a moment, because that's definitely something that will help bring in the pollinators. So it's just another method of succession planting, just like you would your vegetables. You plant your lettuces maybe every 2 to 3 weeks, and then you plant another crop so that you can continually have a harvest. It's the same thing with your flowers. You can definitely continue to plant and succession plant your flowers as well. So let me know here in the chat what flowers you like to succession plant, and do a couple of these things, and you're bound to have a lot more pollinators in your garden this spring. Okay, what would you do if you had fire ants in your garden beds? You know what, I have a video on how to get rid of ants. Now, we don't have fire ants, so I'm not quite sure how aggressive those are. I think they're probably a little bit more aggressive than the ants we have here, but you can make some DIY traps. You can try it on the fire ants to see if it works. You mix borage and sugar and kind of make a little paste out of it. You can put it in like little bottle caps or on pieces of cardboard around your garden beds. Give that a try. See if it works on fire ants too. And just look up ants on my YouTube channel and you should see a little video pop up on that. And then let us know how it works on fire ants as well. Janae, great idea. I think I can't remember who else mentioned to plant peas in hanging baskets or sweet peas or peas. Yeah, that's a great way to kind of save space. Right behind me here, I've got the hanging baskets with the Smart Pots basket liners, which work really well, super sturdy, do not fall apart like the core liners do. Yeah, and right now I've got flowers planted in them, but in another little section right over here in my garden, I have some planted with peas and lettuce. So a great way to save space. Think beyond the flowers. I mean, it's great to have flowers for the bees, but think beyond the flowers or interplant one with flowers and vegetables to save some space, especially if you're growing on a balcony or patio. And peas have beautiful flowers too that also helps bring in the pollinators. Okay, Glore T, what can I do to keep squirrels away from eating and letting the pollinators come in? Okay, I wish we all had great answer to that problem, Glore T. A couple of tips that I like to do, and we're gonna be posting another video on this later this week, are you can cover your garden beds with tulle, which is a type of see-through type netting type of fabric. It still allows the sun to get through, but I've also been using a product from Bonide. I've actually used it for a couple of years now called Repels All. You can sprinkle the granules, they have a spray, and it irritates the animals' nasal passages. And then when they smell it or touch it, it kind of brings up their natural instinct to leave. It doesn't harm them at all, but it really does help keep them away. So you might want to give that a try. It's called Bonide Repels All, and we've been having some really good results with that as well. Okay, end of the road Gordon Flower Farm. I have, let's see, foxglove, straw flower, those are really nice, astibi stock, I haven't heard of that one, paper daisies, and many, many started indoors and will be starting more soon. So yeah, definitely dedicate a portion of your grow lights, if you have grow lights, to flowers. If you don't have grow lights and the weather is getting a little more mild, like it is here, it's been in the 60s, you can start your cooler vegetables right out here on your deck or your patio on a deck rail. Excuse me, as long as you're not, getting a frost. If you're getting a frost, just bring them in at night. And that way it saves you some time of having to, you know, put them under your grow lights. And you don't have to harden them off. It saves you that time. And it's just a really easy way to get some flowers going. So great job on that. Okay, we're going to go ahead and do our second drawing for our second winner for the subscription box. So I want to give my niece Jocelyn a shout out for this. And you can find her on Instagram on Jocelyn Davis Art. But she's the one that drew this. We gave her some ideas and then she drew this entire beautiful piece of artwork. Every single side of the box is covered with a really fun, just motivating like message to help us grow our vegetables. And did you guys know that you can also use the box to plant in? You can compost it and you can use it to store your seeds. I actually have several of them in my garage, storing like stickers and just different things I need, garden tools, things like that. So when you get your box, you get the contents, but you also get the box, not to mention the cute little picture of Mac on the side. Camera guy and I, we're just having a lot of fun with this, and I'm so glad that you are too. Okay, so here we are, guys. I'm gonna turn the camera around again and do our drawing, our second winner. Move the tripod down just a little bit to my computer, so bear with me just a second. There we go. And our second winner, US resident, hopefully. And I'm sorry that we can't ship internationally right now, for the box anyway. There's just lots of different reasons why we're not able to do that. Hopefully at some point we will be able to. But here we go. The winner is of the second Grow Your Groceries with Callie Kim subscription box, Carol Meissen. So congratulations, Carol. And Carol's comment is, I'm looking forward to adding more pollinator-friendly plants to my garden area. And perfect comment for today's live stream, Carol. because that's what we're talking about today. And spring is a great time to add those. And hopefully you'll watch today's live stream if you're not on here already, and you'll have some more ideas on how to plant pollinators for your garden. So Carol, make sure you send me your contact information, CallieKim@CallieKimGardeningHome.com. Please do it as soon as you can so we can get your subscription box shipped out to you. And I know you're going to really enjoy growing your groceries with us. So congratulations, Carol. Thank you so much for entering. And thanks to everyone else who entered as well. And as we go throughout the spring and the summer months, we'll be bringing you more giveaways and more fun times. We've got lots of fun content planned for the spring. So you definitely want to share it with your friends, subscribe, and you don't want to miss any videos. And End of the Road Gordon Flower Farm, we don't ship the subscription boxes internationally at this point in time. We do ship our seed collections, smart pots, my garden books, and the garden kits to several different international countries, and those are noted there on the website. Hopefully we'll be able to expand the subscription boxes at some point in time, but I'm really sorry, just not yet. So hang in there, be patient, and thanks you all. Thank you all for subscribing and supporting our brand new product. It's been a lot of fun. Okay, let's move on to tip number three to bring in the pollinators. And before I forget to do that, I wanted to mention, a lot of you have been asking over the past several months about the mini compost sack. So Smart Pots, just let me know on Friday that it is now available over at smartpots.com. So if you're looking to compost and you have a small space, this is the perfect one for you. It's 50 gallons, so it's a much smaller compost sack than the really large one that they have. It has a cover that you can purchase along with it, and it's a perfect way to compost in a small space, keeps it nice and contained. So go over to smartpots.com and grab yours and use the code CallieKim, you get 10% off. But I know a lot of you have been waiting for that, so I did want to let you know that it is now available. Perfect time to start composting for spring. Okay, let's see here. Tip number three is make sure that you plant flowers that have fragrance, flowers and plants that have fragrance, because it does really bring in the pollinators. And this is something that I didn't always realize in my garden, but I'm starting to notice more and more that they're really drawn to plants that are very aromatic. And particularly think about herbs, super aromatic herbs like oregano, sage, thyme, basil, mint. I mean, all those herbs, you can walk through your garden, rosemary, and just kind of run your hands along, you know, those herbs and you can smell it. Absolutely beautiful. Borage, yes, borage, bees do love borage. I think that was that Charlene. Yes, Charlene, bees do love borage, and it does have a beautiful scent. It has those purple flowers. That's actually an herb as well, but definitely plant those aromatics in your garden to bring on the pollinators. Now, the cool thing about that is if you leave a couple of those to flower, now typically herbs you want to harvest before they flower for the best flavor, but if you leave a couple of them to flower, plant extra, the bees absolutely love the flowers of the herbs. If you've ever let your basil flower, or I have a sage plant that's been in my little herb garden area for probably about 10 years. It grows here year round. I cut it back year after year after it flowers and kind of goes to seed. It has beautiful purple flowers. The bees absolutely love them. And I actually just planted I think it's a red blooming sage in the front yard. It's a very small plant right now with a few blooms on it, but already the bees are just flocking to it. So it's pretty crazy how much that the fragrance, especially when combined with the flowers, really, really brings in the pollinators. So I would highly recommend that. Lavender, oh my gosh. If anyone grows lavender, you know how much the bees absolutely love the lavender. So let me know in the chat what aromatic plants and herbs you enjoy planting for the pollinators, but definitely always include those in your planting plan for the spring. And you can grab my herb garden seed collection too if you don't have any seeds. The seeds in there are super easy to grow herbs. Some of the herbs are a little bit harder to start from seed, such as the sage, some of the perennials, the oregano, the thyme. Those take a little bit of patience, but the ones I have in my seed collection, super easy, and you can get those going, and that way you have plenty of aromatic plants for the pollinators to enjoy. And Anna, welcome. I just saw you. This is my first live ever. Happy spring, everyone. I'm so glad that you're here. You're starting off your spring right with us here, celebrating spring together, just enjoying. The sun's actually coming out now. It's really pretty. Hardening off the plants. We just did a couple drawings. It's a really fun day, enjoying the community that we have here. And I'm going to scroll back. I saw someone ask about Tiny Tim. Can you plant it in a 1 gallon? I'm not sure who that was. I lost the comment here. But I would tell you, you can start it off in a 1 gallon. I actually think it grows better or gets off to a better start when you start it in a smaller type of container. Here's a little cow pot here. This is the perfect little size to start your plants in. These are in my Grow Your Groceries with Callie Kim subscription boxes. But I love to start them off in smaller containers. And then this one, I don't think this is a Tiny Tim. I forget what kind of tomato that is right there. You can transplant them into a 1 gallon if they're not quite ready to go outside, if the weather's not warm enough. But I highly recommend, if you're gonna put them in their permanent home, that it be at least a 5 gallon. A 1 gallon really just isn't quite big enough for them. But a 5 gallon is perfect. You get a lot more tomatoes that way. The 5 gallon Calikims, you can find over on my website in black and in 3 different vivid colors. And then you can just put a small little tomato cage around it and you're gonna have a ton of tomatoes. That little plant is so productive. I always try and have some going in my garden and love to grow them all summer long. It's also a great one to succession plant. And the Tiny Tim seeds, by the way, are in the Container Garden Seed Collection, the Late Summer Garden Seed Collection, and you can also get them under the Smart Pots portion of my website with a 5 gallon container. You can see them there with the Smart Pot seeds and a black 5 gallon. So if you don't want to purchase a whole entire seed collection, you can grab them there with a 5 gallon and you'll be all set and good to go. Okay, Lemmy, how you doing, Lemmy? My Tiny Tim seedlings are starting to flower already. Should I pinch off the flowers? Yeah, you might want to go ahead and pinch those off just so all the energy of the Tiny Tim goes into producing leaves and getting a little bit bigger rather than into producing flowers and then tomatoes. So yeah, I would go ahead and do that until you get your plant outside in the garden. So hopefully by now, typically I have a lot of things planted in the garden, a lot of warm weather veggies, but it's just been too soggy and too cold. So hopefully over the next couple of weeks, we'll start doing more videos of planting the tomatoes and the peppers and all the warm weather veggies outside. But my soil is soggy. We're trying to let that dry out a little bit. And we've even still had nights into the 30s, believe it or not. So we're really looking forward to the warm up coming real soon. You're welcome, Lemmy. Hope that helps. Okay, let me take one more question before we head into the next tip here. And let's see here if I can see any more questions here. I like to pot up, where'd that go, from Ecocentric Homestead 2 or 3 times because they'll be deep and drought resistant then. Yeah, that's always a good idea. If you have the time and the space to up pot, always a good idea if you can put them into the garden a little bit bigger. They're a little bit stronger plants and yes, could potentially be more drought resistant. I don't always have space for that, so I don't always do that. I like to try and harden off some of my seedlings before I pot them up, if I'm gonna pot them up, just because I'm totally overrun in the house right now and I like to get them outside. I do have a little shelf over on the side of my house where I'll be putting several of the Smart Pots with larger tomatoes, up potted tomatoes. As I have time to plant them in the garden, I'll just pull from that shelf and you know, that way they'll already be hardened off and ready to roll. Okay, so tip number, I believe this is tip number 4 for bringing the pollinators into your garden. And that is, let some of your veggies and herbs bloom. Let some of them go to seed, in other words. So if you're not familiar with the veggies going to seed, what happens is, for example, right now is a perfect time to grow lettuce until it gets about 75 or 80 degrees consistently. It likes the cool weather. It just doesn't like the hot weather. It's not gonna continue to grow all summer long unless you live in a cooler climate. So what happens is from the middle, this tall stalk shoots up, it's called bolting, and it will bloom. So once the vegetable or the herb bolts, it changes the flavor of the leaves. So the flowers will bloom. The pollinators absolutely love the flowers. So I always try and plant a little bit of extra. In fact, you can see, I don't know if you guys can see right through the deck rail, is some broccoli that is actually blooming. The broccoli, you know, is very, very heat sensitive. So once I get a hot day, oftentimes my broccoli will start to bolt and open up the little, it won't bolt, but it'll actually, the florets will open up, and that's the flowers. So I always leave them in because I think they're really pretty and the bees absolutely love them. So if I don't get it harvested in time, it's no big loss because it will bring the pollinators into my garden like crazy. And the same thing goes with the herbs. If you've got some basil that's starting to bloom, right now the parsley and cilantro are a cool weather herb. But again, once the warm weather hits, they're going to start to bolt and blossom and bloom, and then the pollinators will come in like crazy. Now, once the blossoms dry up, you're going to have seeds in there. So that's a good time after then, after you know this, they completely dry, to harvest the seeds. Then you can plant them again and start the whole beautiful cycle all over again. And save your seeds, sell, you know, save yourself on having to purchase seeds or give some to a friend. That's always really fun too, to help someone else get started. So definitely plant extra so you have plenty of blooms of your veggies and herbs for the pollinators. Don't be dismayed if they bolt. It's just a different, you know, season of time for that plant, and the pollinators will be attracted to that like crazy. Okay, Stacy, how are you doing? Great to have you here, Stacy Casey. And the question is, will seedlings grow under a grow light, or should I use a heat pad? Maryland is 40 degrees, a little chilly still there in Maryland. And Stacy, what you want to do is look at the type of vegetable that you're growing there underneath your grow lights. Your cool weather vegetables are not going to need a heat pad because it would be way too hot for them. You could just pop them under the grow lights in your little seed cells or your little 4-inch pots or whatever it is that you're growing them in, and they'll grow absolutely beautifully, keep the soil nice and moist, so the seedlings germinate. However, if you're growing some warm weather vegetables like these cucumbers and your house is kind of chilly, it's 40 degrees outside, it might be in the 60s in your house inside, you will want to put them on a heat mat, especially your peppers and eggplant. They particularly benefit from bottom heat, but that a heat mat provides, but you can kind of compromise a little bit if you put them in a warm spot in your house, maybe on top of the refrigerator, maybe near like a heating vent or something like that. And then once they germinate, pop them under the heat mats. But heat mats are not that expensive. I think they run maybe $15 on Amazon. If you can put it into your garden budget, they're well worth it. It will definitely help your warm weather veggies germinate a little bit quicker. Now, if you're not sure what are cool weather veggies and warm weather veggies, I've got a whole chart in the back of my book on raised bed gardening. So you have, you know, what type of veggie it is, what temperature they grow best at, when to start indoors, when to plant outdoors, and when to succession plant. So a really good resource for you, for a new gardener and for an experienced gardener as well. You can grab that. Again, 30% off today with the code SPRINGISHERE over on my website, kellykimgardeninghome.com. So really good question there. Okay, Paula, I have 3 cucumber starts that I grew in one pot. Should I break them apart to transplant or let them grow together? Okay, cucumbers, again, I'll grab my little cucumber plant here. Cucumbers do not always like to have their roots disturbed. So you probably won't have a lot of success if you try and break the plants apart. You might end up really putting them under some stress. They might not make it. So I would just go ahead and plant them like this. Cucumbers actually do pretty well planted closely together. This one has 4 plants, but what I would do is, if it was me, this is a cow pot that biodegrades very easily. I'm going to pop this right in my soil, hopefully within a couple of weeks, and the cow pot will biodegrade, unlike some of the other pots out there on the market. And then you just kind of leave the strongest seedling, see how they grow, and leave the strongest, I'd probably leave 2 in here to grow. And then you can kind of snip at soil level the other 2. I know that's really hard to do, but it really does help help when you do that, when your plants are too close together, so they're not competing for nutrients and water. And then just have extras planted. I've got several little cow pots planted. This is actually a butternut squash, only 1 in here. And that way you have plenty growing and plenty to plant. And cucumbers you can plant all summer long as well. You can easily succession plant those once a month or so you don't run out of cucumbers to eat and to harvest. Okay, great question there. Thank you so much for popping in with that. Okay, I'm gonna run through tips number 5 and 6 pretty quickly. Tip number five is make sure that you supply the pollinators with a drink, okay? So have some water for the pollinators in your garden. And a really great way to do that with hummingbirds is with a little hummingbird feeder. We love this. It's so much fun to sit out here. Even as we were getting ready for the live stream, Jerry had just refilled the feeder yesterday, I think, and there's a little hummingbird that came to visit. So in the summer times, we're out here every evening watching the hummingbirds come to the feeder. It's so much fun. They actually fly around behind us here and kind of fight. The males and the females are always zooming, you know, back and forth, or maybe it's the males that are fighting over the females. I don't know, but it's really fun to watch them. So always have a hummingbird feeder in your garden. They're readily available at garden centers. They're not that expensive. Grab them on Amazon or make your own. You can also make or have a bird bath out there. Our fountain that we have down there, the birds love to kind of, you know, fly through there and drink the water, leave little trays of water with rocks in them out in your garden for the birds and the bees to have a little drink. And, you know, they need water just like we do. And sometimes it's kind of hard to come by. Right now with all the rain, there's plenty to come by. But in the summertime when things get hot, it's not always readily available. So definitely whatever you can do to put little fountains that kind of recirculate the water and bring the water up for the pollinators, you're going to help bring the pollinators in that much more to your garden. So definitely recommend that. One more tip that we're going to run through, and then we have a few more minutes for questions at the end, is if you can, I highly recommend sticking to organic pesticides for your garden. Now, hopefully you don't have to use pesticides, but reality of it is the pests and the bugs do come in to our garden at some point in the summer. They do to mine too. And especially now when it's been super wet here, super damp, I've noticed a lot of things getting chowed down. I've had some aphids inside the house. So when you can, limit your use of pesticides. When you do have to use them, make sure that you're using organic pesticides and only spray the affected areas so you're not affecting the pollinators. Now, I always go with water first to rinse off any bugs, because a lot of times if you're rinsing off the aphids off your plants and you do that a couple of times, you know, daily or, you know, a couple days in a row, a lot of times the aphids aren't going to come back. But if you do have to use a pesticide, make sure it's organic. There's lots of good ones out there. We'll be doing more videos on that over the next coming months. But spray when the bees and the pollinators aren't as active, early in the morning or later in the evening. Try to avoid the flowers and just spray the affected areas of the plant. So you definitely want to make sure that we're taking care of the bees as much as we can by using the organic pesticides if it's absolutely necessary. And definitely sometimes it is. Okay, so that's all the pollinator tips I have for you for today. Hopefully that helps you bring a lot more pollinators into your garden in the coming months. And I would love to hear any more tips you have to bring pollinators in. So let me know in the chat what flowers you'd love to plant, what tips you have for bringing more bees, butterflies, hummingbirds, pollinators into your garden. I would love to hear about it. And congratulations again to the winners of the giveaway as well. Okay, can I put my lettuce in a bigger pot from Dawn Star? Absolutely, yeah. I just repotted some lettuce myself from little six packs to a little shorty. So you can absolutely repot your lettuce. I highly recommend that actually to get, you know, larger plants. And you also wanna make sure that if your lettuce is planted too close together in your little seedling trays, that you go ahead and thin those out. Because that way you're going to give more space to grow larger heads or larger plants of lettuce. So definitely do that. Okay, thank you so much, Smart Pots, for being here. Smart Pot says, as always, thank you so much to Callie Kim, Camera Guy, and Mac. And we always appreciate and love Smart Pots being here and popping in all their valuable information as well. And do make sure you visit smartpots.com. Don't forget about that mini compost sack with the code CALLIKIM. You can get 10% off of that. And we will be doing a video on how to compost in that coming up in the next few weeks. And Anna, I'm so glad you asked this question. Is that a passion fruit cutting in the background? And I don't know if Debbie Wheeler is on here. I meant to show her this today. This is my dragon fruit. I'm so excited because Debbie gave me this dragon fruit cutting. And it's actually growing. So I tried rooting three cuttings. This one has really taken off. And this Smart Pots here is full of roots. And actually growing a new little, I forget what this is called, new little area on the top. And hopefully this summer, we are going to be planting this in probably a large size smart pots, maybe even a 30 gallon. So we have some dragon fruit. We do have a passion fruit down another area of our garden, but this one is the dragon fruit. So I'm really glad you noticed that. So thank you so much, Debbie, for that. We'll always think about you, and hopefully we'll get some dragon fruit sometime soon. KV says, be very vigilant. Let's see, where'd that go? With your hummingbird feeders. I'm very glad you mentioned this, KV. I meant to mention that as well. If they, where'd it go here? If they aren't kept clean and the nectary fresh, the feeders can grow fungus and it could be fatal to the hummingbird. So thank you so much for bringing that up. Yes, we actually only fill our feeder a couple inches because we want to continually be refreshing it and keeping it clean. And the ratio is 1/4. I don't want to say it wrong. It's 1/4 sugar to 4 parts water. So in other words, like 1/4 cup of sugar to a cup of water. You don't want to make it too strong. You want to make it at that ratio so you don't harm the hummingbirds, and definitely do clean your feeder every single time you fill it, and refresh it often. So thank you so much for bringing that up. Really appreciate it. Okay, we're going to go ahead and sign off for today. What a great time, guys, to hang out with you on the very first day of spring. And Jerry, great job being Jerry Vanna. And for the fire, too. Jerry always does a great job getting things set up and looking nice here for the live stream.
Yeah, it's always great to see everybody here and chatting and sharing advice across the board. It's really cool.
Definitely. And do make sure you join us. We'll be back here again next Monday. Some other fun garden tips, great fun community to be a part of. So don't forget, Monday's noon Pacific time. We're right here. And please do take advantage of the 30% off sale. Today only ends at midnight Pacific time with the code SPRINGISHERE over at CallieKimGardeningHome.com. Get your growing, get your groceries growing, and get your veggie garden planted.
And get over to Smart Pots and get that, what was it called again?
The mini compost sack.
Yeah. Finally.
Absolutely.
Way to stay on that.
Production. All right. Okay, guys. See you later. Have a great first week of spring. Bye-bye.
Bye.